Pulp stones, also known as denticles, are nodular calcified masses appearing in dental pulp. We can find many such ectopic calcifications in other parts of the body. Classification. Depending on their location, pulp stones can be classified as coronal pulp stones when pulp stones are located in the coronal part of the pulp, that is, the pulp chamber, and radicular pulp stone when pulp stones are located in the radicular part of the pulp, that is, in the pulp canals. Radicular pulp stones are more common than coronal pulp stones. Depending on their structure, pulp stones can be classified as true pulp stones when pulp stones are structurally similar to dentine. They have odontoblasts at the periphery, dentinal tubules with odontoblastic processes running through the pulp stone. True pulp stones are more common near the root apex. And false pulp stones, when pulp stones are not similar to dentine, they appear as concentric layers of calcification. False pulp stones are more common than true pulp stones. Depending on the relationship with dentine, pulp stones can be classified as free pulp stones when pulp stones are entirely surrounded by pulp tissue, attached pulp stones when pulp stones are partially fused with dentine, and embedded pulp stones when pulp stones are entirely surrounded by dentine. Now, how are pulp stones formed? Well, that depends on what type of pulp stone are we talking about. There are some theories. Formation of true pulp stones. During the stages of tooth development, specifically speaking during root formation, the cells of Hertwig's epithelial root sheath initiate differentiation of cells of dental papilla into odontoblasts, which in turn deposit radicular dentine. It is theorized that few cells of this root sheath may get incorporated into the dental pulp. These cells then induce cells of the pulp to differentiate into odontoblasts, which in turn deposit dentine and form pulp stones. Formation of false pulp stones. In this case, it is theorized that few contents of the pulp may act as a nidus for calcification, which once initiated continues with layered deposition of more minerals. The nidus may be a collagen fiber, blood vessel, or necrotic cells. Formation of pulp stones in relationship to dentine. It is theorized that initially all pulp stones formed are free pulp stones. With time, as secondary dentine deposition continues and size of the pulp chamber reduces, the pulp stone first gets attached to the dentine and then finally gets completely embedded in dentine. Incidence. It is known that the incidence of pulp stones depends on the age of the patients, such that as the age of the patient increases, the number of pulp stones increase. According to some reports, a person between 10 to 30 years will have some calcification in 66% of teeth. A person between 30 to 50 years will have some calcification in 80% of teeth. And a person over 50 years will have some calcification in 90% of teeth. Symptoms. The patient in this case is completely asymptomatic and is unaware of the presence of pulp stones. Diagnosis. Pulp stones are diagnosed by radiographic investigations. In a dental radiograph, all the calcified structures, that is enamel, dentine and bone, appear radio-opaque. Only the pulp appears radiolucent. Pulp stone appears as a radio-opacity in the pulp chamber as it is also a calcified structure. Finally, treatment. Pulp stones require no treatment. Although, during treatment of an infected tooth, having a pulp stone, the dentist may find it difficult to carry out the root canal treatment.